Good morning, everyone. Morning, good to have you with us, especially if you're visiting. A very warm welcome to Hope Church this Sunday morning. We'll start with some notices, and the first one's not really a notice, it's a letter. So it's from Judith Crown, Don Brown's daughter. Just a thank you letter, which I'll read out for us, because it's not just me, it's just the Hope Church family. She writes, with her husband Tom, "Dear friends, I'm writing to thank you for the wonderful way that you, as a congregation, provided fellowship, family and support to Dad over a period of many years, enabling him to serve his Lord in the way that best used his gifts and talents. You were an integral part of his life, and he valued each and every one of you. It was such a wonderful experience to see everything you had provided for the funeral in collaboration with the Life Vineyard Church, and to see your love for Dad and for us as a family. We're so blessed to know you." And then she quotes from Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. "I thank my God every time I remember you. In my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. We hope to come and worship with you sometime soon. Tom and Judith Crown." It's a lovely letter, and thank God for that. I'll leave it out over on the table if any of you want to take a second read later. An update from our church family meeting last Sunday. Thank you. I know some of you couldn't join us, many could. Thank you for your contributions. The minutes for that meeting are available on the church family section of the website. So if you're on the WhatsApp group, you can get through that way. Or if you can't get access for any reason you'd like to, do chat to Helen and she can help with that. The main things we discussed were thoughts about a possible building in the future, a bit of discussion there. And the main thing was to talk about Easter plans. So we have some plans for Easter. Yes, praise God. Now, thank you for your contributions and also ideas that fed through in the week. As I go through, I'll mention a person or people who are coordinating each event. That doesn't mean that those people do all the work, but the rest of us sit back and say thank you. But it just means they're a point person. So if we would like to help with that, or if we want to know more, we can go to them to ask for info. So let's go through the events. So Wednesday, this is a couple of weeks before Easter, week commencing the 18th of March, the final date to be confirmed, but there'll be a pub quiz in the Wetherspoons in the evening. Matthew's going to be coordinating that, so chat to him if you'd like to help or got ideas about that. The advantage of that is it's a downstairs venue, so easily accessible. And then Friday the 29th, that's Good Friday. We've got Sega dinner for the whole day on Good Friday. So that's exciting. In the morning, Easter gardens, and then a church family lunch for all you can join, and then an hour at the cross with communion in the afternoon. And I believe John and Julia are coordinating that, so do chat to them again if you'd like to help or you've got ideas. Saturday, Easter Saturday, we start the Easter Trail. So that's Claire and Helen are organising the details of that, but it'll be involved sending families and people around the community to find clues and get answers, and then come back for the Saturday the 6th of April, the Walls in Library event. So sort of the Easter Trail feeds into the library event, which is Saturday after Easter in the Walls End Library. And then Sunday the 31st, Easter Sunday service here. So those are kind of the official events. There are also at least one unofficial event going on. So Michelle, for example, is organising an afternoon tea event in our house with some friends or hairdressing clients. We've done a deal, so she's going to provide the venue, and I'm going to provide a speaker for that. So if you'd like to do that, if you've got friends living close to you, or maybe neighbours, and you thought, well, actually, I'd quite like to do a small scale thing, and just invite people around, have some lunch sandwiches with a short talk or a testimony. Let's do it. So just come and talk to me if you want to do something like that, or just get on and do it yourself. There's nothing to stop you. So that's the rough plan. Obviously, details to be ironed out. Any questions or comments on anything I've missed, possibly, that you want to ask? Brilliant. Very good. Yeah. Yeah, so Easter is Sunday to the 31st of March, not the 31st of April. Thank you. Yeah. Well, let's be praying. So remember the three goals for Easter Hour, which is to celebrate Easter ourselves as a church family, number one. Number two, to share the good news with people we already know. And then number three, to sort of reach out beyond the edge and share the good news with some people we don't know, particularly in the Walls End area. Well, let me pray, and then we can make a start of the service. Father, we do thank you for the way that you helped us in the lead up to the funeral. We thank you for the partnership with the Life Vineyard Church. We thank you for the kindness and love and partnership in the gospel shown by Judith and Claire, Don's family. And we pray, Lord, that the partnerships with like-minded churches in the community will develop, and that we would be able to partner for the advance of the gospel in this area. We thank you for these Easter events. Thank you for the way that you've helped us and given us guidance. We pray that you give us strength to run these events. But we pray above all that people would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross that Good Friday, rose again on Easter Sunday. By the Holy Spirit, they come to know him as their Lord and their Saviour. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray together our opening prayer as we meet together. Our Father in heaven, as we meet in your presence this morning and hear your word, give us power, together with Christians all around the world, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, so that we may be filled to all the measure of the fullness of God, and so increase our love for you and our love for our neighbour. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in recent weeks we've been going through Matthew's Gospel, which we continue today, and we've been meeting all sorts of people who have nothing to offer Jesus at all, apart from their sickness and their sin. But they came to Jesus just as they were and found that in him they had all the help that they needed. And that is how we approach to Jesus today, just as we are, asking him to help us. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Last week we read of the meal that Jesus and his friends had with Matthew the tax collector and his friends just after Jesus had called him. We read that while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. But when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" And last week, Matthew, our Matthew, not Matthew the Gospel writer, warned us graciously in his sermon that how easy it is for us over time to become self-righteous like the Pharisees. So we're going to use some words from an Anglican homily, which is part of a sermon series originally written by Thomas Cranmer and others back in the 16th century, at the beginning of the foundation of the Church of England. We're going to use these words to humble ourselves before God. I'm going to read out a section, and then there's a responsive section at the end. So, brothers and sisters, let us confess with mouth and heart that we are full of imperfections. Let us know our own works, how imperfect they are, and then we shall not stand foolishly and arrogantly in our own conceits, nor think we can obtain justification by our merits or works. For truly, there are imperfections in our best works. We do not love God so much as we are bound to do with all our hearts, mind, and power. We do not fear God so much as we ought to. We do not pray to God, but with great and many imperfections. We forgive, believe, live, and hope imperfectly. We fight against the devil, the world, and the flesh imperfectly. Let us therefore not be ashamed to confess plainly the state of our imperfection. Indeed, let us not be ashamed to confess imperfection even in all our best works. Let us say with David, "We have sinned like our fathers, we have done wrong and acted wickedly." Let us make open confession with the prodigal son to our father and say with him, "We have sinned against heaven and against you, O Father, we are not worthy to be called your children." Jesus then responded to the Pharisees. He said this, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but those who are ill. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." As Matthew reminded us last week, Jesus is the sin doctor, always on call, and no case too difficult or too complicated for him to deal with. And praise the Lord, that is open to you and to I as we come to him. Let's stand and sing.
Morning. This is the fourth of our five Bible talks on passages from John's Gospel. And the aim of these talks is not only to encourage the children, but all of us to keep following Jesus when life is tough. I find it hard to trust that Jesus will always look after me. Well, if you're thinking along these lines, then let me reassure you with some great words and wonderful promises of Jesus from John 10. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. Jesus said these words in response to his Jewish opponents who don't believe in him. Jesus says, you don't believe because you are not my sheep. There's a contrast in this passage between those who believe in Jesus and those who don't believe. Belief in Jesus means believing in him when he says, I am God's son, and putting your trust in him. Belief in Jesus also means listening to his teaching. My sheep listen to my voice. They listen and they follow. Jesus knows his sheep, and his sheep know him. They don't just know about him, they know him. They know him personally. And he says, they follow me. To believe in Jesus is to follow him wherever he takes you. And Jesus promises every true Christian eternal life. It starts with the moment you believe and put your trust in him, and this relationship will go on and on forever. It will never end. And Jesus promises that those who follow him will never perish. Now, my note from Ben about this talk said includes an interaction. So we're going to have a bit of interaction now. I'm just confining it to the children. So Finley and Izzy, if you could come to the front, please. And we're going to have a game. I don't know if you've heard of it. It's called Bang, Clap, Snatch. Out of my hand and tossed around the classroom. I think because I was the smallest in the class, And when I was on holiday in St. Ives years ago, I had a seagull came down and took the ice cream out of my hand. Yes, I don't have any problems with the television controls. Anyway, Jesus promises that no one can snatch his sheep out of his hands or out of his Father's hands. Jesus has already said that he's the good shepherd who lays down his life for his sheep. Here he says he holds his sheep securely in his hands forever. So the hand of Jesus and the hand of God are one together, and they protect us. But that doesn't mean that life will be easy. Further on in John 16, Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. The Bible is very realistic. It doesn't promise that life will be easy, and it's not. The country has been battered by storms recently, has it? Hasn't it? Storm Aisha and Storm Jocelyn. And sometimes life is like being in a storm. We can feel battered and bruised by it. And 2 weeks ago, Ben reminded us that the point of life is not actually getting through these storms, but to trust fully in Jesus, who wants us to trust him more and more, and to rely on God and not on ourselves. And that can only happen when he leads us through these trials, these storms. But whatever happens, we're secure in Jesus' hands, and in the hands of the Father, with the Holy Spirit living in us. Even Fort Knox, the most secure vault on the planet, is not as secure as a Christian in the hands of our God. Isn't that wonderful? How reassuring that is to us when we go through the storms of life. I don't find it hard to trust that Jesus will look after me. I don't, and that's because he has always looked after me, and I've been through a few storms. And Jesus has never let me down. He never breaks his promises, and he's the one person I trust always to look after me. And you can trust that Jesus will look after you too, 100%. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the Lord Jesus, our good shepherd, who looks after his sheep, and who knows and loves every one of them, and promises the gift of eternal life to all who follow him. Help us to continue to listen to the teaching of Jesus, and to follow him wherever he takes us, safe in the knowledge that whatever happens, we are secure in his love, and need not be afraid. Help us to trust in him more and more. In his name we pray. Amen.
I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. Your cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you, Julie and Margaret. In a moment, we're going to say the Apostles' Creed together. It's Trinitarian. It reminds us of our belief as Christians in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And we are secure in the Trinity. If we're Jesus' sheep, and he is our shepherd, nothing can snatch us out of his hand, or out of his Father's hand. And we read of the security the Holy Spirit gives us in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. It says, God has put his Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. So let's stand if you're able, and let's declare our Christian faith in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Do stay standing down. Individual Christians are secure in Christ, so is the entire Church of Christ down the ages and around the world, as we remember the words of our next song.
Let's pray together. I'd like to start our prayers today with the Lord's Prayer. Let's say the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I was having difficulty writing these prayers, so I turned to the hymn writer Stuart Townend for help. So let's pray his words for ourselves and for each other. Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Let the presence of the risen Lord come renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive in me. Give me faith for what I cannot see. Give me passion for your purity. Holy Spirit, breathe new life in me. Holy Spirit, come abide within. May your joy be seen in all I do. Love enough to cover every sin in each thought and deed and attitude. Kindness to the greatest and the least. Gentleness that sows the path of peace. Turn my strivings into works of grace. Breath of God, show Christ in all I do. Holy Spirit, from creation's birth, giving life to all that God has made, show your power once again on earth. Cause your church to hunger for your ways. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice, that in unity the face of Christ may be clear for all the world to see. Amen. And some prayers of thanks. Father, we thank you for our church family, for each person present here today. We thank you for a place to meet, the freedom to meet together without fear of intimidation, for friendship and fellowship in Jesus' name, for the opportunities we have to study the Bible together and to pray together. We thank you for our toddler group and ask you to bless the meeting this Tuesday with fun, friendship, and meaningful conversations. We ask you to be with us as we meet in our midweek groups to study your word, for your Holy Spirit to speak to us, teach us, and excite us. We ask your blessing upon the gathering at Eotham on Friday, thanking you for the opportunity to visit there each week, and we ask that those who attend would be stimulated and comforted as they hear and sing about Jesus. We ask that the book group will be a time of fellowship and encouragement, and we ask the same for the Women's Convention next weekend. And we thank you for the opportunities that Easter brings. We ask that our Easter plans may be in accordance with your will and purpose, and that they would bring glory to you. Amen. Amen. And I think we're all aware that many of us have heavy hearts and are in need of God's comfort at the moment. So let's listen to Psalm 131 as the psalmist admits his own limitations and asks for an attitude of quiet trust. My heart is not proud, Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me. But I have calmed and quietened my soul. I am like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child, I am content. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forever. Amen. Let's end by saying the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore.
Where is God in the pain and mess of our lives? The playwright George Bernard Shaw once thought that God simply was not there in the pain and mess of our lives. He once wrote this: how are atheists produced? In 9 cases out of 10 probably, what happens is something like this. A beloved husband or wife or child or sweetheart is gnawed to death by cancer, stultified by epilepsy, struck dumb and helpless by apoplexy, or strangled by croup or diphtheria. And the looker on, after praying vainly to God to refrain from such horrible and wanton cruelty, indignantly repudiates faith in the divine monster and becomes not merely indifferent and sceptical, but fiercely and actively hostile to religion. Strong words from George Bernard Shaw. I don't think you'll meet too many Bernard Shaws today, though. If people we know personally turn away from God because of a time of suffering, it's likely to be less dramatic and more gradual. It's more likely that more people will slowly give up on a God who just over time doesn't seem to care and doesn't seem to help. A couple of years back, I remember speaking with two women who lived in the Walkergate area. Both grew up believing in God. One was definitely connected with the church. I think the other one was too. But then both faced awful tragedy in their lives. For one lady, it was the death of her grandchild. For another lady, it was the death of her husband to cancer. And for both of them, that suffering was too much. They couldn't bring themselves to continue to believe in a God who would allow something like that to happen. They could look back on the days when they had followed God, but there was no way that they could trust God now in the pain and mess of their lives and in the future. In our Bible passage today, the Gospel writer Matthew is bringing us face to face with Jesus, God on earth, God living among us. Where is God in the pain and mess of our lives? Let's find out. Before we do that, let's pray. Heavenly Father, by the help of your Holy Spirit, please open our eyes so that we may see wonderful things in your word and find comfort as we place our hope and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, I've got 4 points today. Firstly, the expectant faith of a distraught father. The expectant faith of a distraught father. Chapter 9, verse 18, following on from last week. While he was saying this, that's Jesus teaching, a synagogue leader came and knelt before him and said, "My daughter has just died, but come, put your hand on her and she will live." Jesus got up and went with him, and so did his disciples. As so often happens in Jesus' earthly ministry, he's interrupted with a pastoral emergency, a major pastoral emergency. This time it was one of the most influential figures in society, the leader of the local synagogue, and he had just experienced every parent's worst nightmare. His daughter had died. Just imagine him a few weeks earlier, smiling at her, playing with friends in the street. But not today, because she died. And here was this broken, distraught man coming to Jesus with a heavy heart. One of the particular painful things about losing a child is that it's against the natural order of things. No parent should have to bury their child. And yet if you ever walk through a cemetery, and take a few minutes to look around the gravestones, you'll realise that there are many old gravestones of children who died in infancy, as many did in centuries past, but also new gravestones too, often with flowers and photos of children who died in infancy, like the child did of my first ever funeral, a 9-month-old boy who died of cancer. Some of us will be aware of what happened to Ian and Tess Garrett last summer. Twin daughters went away on a Christian camp. One of them died on the camp. But amazingly, this grief-stricken man approaches Jesus with expectant faith. He says to Jesus, I know she's dead, but you can make her live. Jesus is willing to help, so he gets up and goes. He meets a desperate woman en route, which we'll look at in a moment. But let's continue the action in verse 23. When Jesus entered the synagogue leader's house and saw the noisy crowd and the people playing pipes, it's worth saying funeral customs were different. So, and in our culture, there's a delay between the death and the waking funeral. There, it was very close together. And also, we culturally tend to be more quiet and contemplative around funerals. In this culture, it's normal. If you see pictures on the news of people grieving, it's wailing, noise, commotion. So different funeral customs. He said, go away. The girl is not dead, but asleep. But they laughed at him. After the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took the girl by the hand, and she got up. News of this spread throughout all that region. Jesus sends out the professional mourners, sends out the crowd, steps in, takes the dead girl by the hand, and she gets up alive. And news spreads like wildfire. Where was God in the pain of that man's life? Well, right there. Jesus brought the dead girl back to life. And you can imagine instantly the change of tone from funeral to joy. But when we read this passage today, what comfort is an passage like that? Like this, to those who grieve the loss of their children today, like the funeral of the family that I took when he died of cancer, or Ian and Tess. Will Jesus bring their daughter back, or their son back? No, the comfort is not in that. The comfort is in God himself and in the promises that he gives. You see, the Bible is totally realistic in its portrayal of our world. We live in a wonderful world, but it's broken. We live in a beautiful world, but life can be really awful. It's created by God, but it's ruined by our sin. And Jesus Christ, God himself, came into our world to summon people to turn back to God and join him in God's new world, where things will be only good all the time. And along with all of his healings, Jesus bringing this particular daughter, he didn't do it for every dad. And remember, there'll be lots of dads who lost their daughters, and that was that. But he did it here, and in other occasions, he did amazing healings to show that he was the one who had power over death. Here was the game changer. Where death is your victory, with this man who can overcome death. Where death is your sting, the one who will defeat you is here. Jesus, the one who can make the dead living. And Jesus himself died, and God the Father rose him from the dead, because death had no hold on him. He ascended to the Father. And now everyone who trusts in him, the moment they trust in him, go from spiritual death to spiritual life. And whoever believes in him will die, but then live with him forever in his perfect new world. When Jesus returns, there will be a division, as Julie was saying there, between those who refuse to believe in him, who he will justly judge in hell, and those who believe in him, who he will welcome into heaven on the basis of what he's done, not because of any goodness in them. So where is God in the pain and mess of our lives? Well, there's not a quick answer, but God has a plan. If you will look to him and trust in him, he has a plan. As many of you know, I'm studying at a theological seminary, and one of the lecturers there lost his daughter when she was a small baby. He and his wife know that God is not going to bring them, their daughter back to them, but they do know that they will go to join her. In the dedication to his book on the Trinity, the lecturer wrote this. In memory of Anastasia Joy Sandlin, and then a quote from Isaiah, behold, I create a new heavens and a new earth, and the former things will not be remembered or come to mind. No more shall there be in it an infant who lives but a few days. A new world. And that's an example today of what it looks like for a distraught father, a distraught mother, to have expectant faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, like this synagogue leader did back then when Jesus was on earth among us. So the expectant faith of a distraught father. Secondly, the desperate faith of a despairing woman. The desperate faith of a despairing woman. As we read through Matthew's Gospel, you can't get around the fact that Jesus' ministry is very relational. He doesn't just move from one big preaching engagement to the next, bypassing the mess in the middle, blanking people in the streets as he hurries off with his entourage with a suitcase to get to the next platform to preach. No, he really cares for individuals. He steps into the mess and pain of people's daily lives, and is not fazed at all by interruptions. Verse 20. Just then, a woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be healed." Matthew here is introducing us to a desperate woman. 12 years ago, she developed a serious bleeding problem. It's been with her ever since. The Gospel writer Mark adds an extra comment about her suffering. He says that she had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, and yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. So here's a woman who's lost everything because of her illness. She lost access to the temple. That was years back when her bleeding problem started. More recently, she's lost all her money. She's probably well down the road, the familiar road of those who suffer, of seeing fair weather friends abandon her in her time of need. She has nothing left, nothing much to live for, no hope to hold on to. She's lost everything apart from her life, but both her and her doctors know that she doesn't have very long left. But she's heard one thing that makes her willing to give hope one last shot. She's heard about this special man, Jesus. She doesn't get everything about him, but she gets enough. She senses that Jesus is different. Where the doctors could not help, Jesus can help. He's done it for others, why not me? So she comes. From the other gospel accounts we see, it's hiding in a crowd, trying to avoid being seen, touches the cloak. What happens? Jesus turned to her and saw her, verse 22. "Take heart, daughter. Your faith has healed you." And the woman was healed at that moment. Jesus heals the woman because of her faith. She trusted Jesus could do what she desperately needed him to do and what he alone could do. Let's take a moment to think through this woman's faith. Firstly, this was a real faith in Jesus Christ. Now that is indisputable. Jesus Christ could see unbelief in people's hearts from 100 paces. If there would have been unbelief, he would have seen it. He was too concerned about people's spiritual welfare to butter them up with false reassurance. And yet he said to this woman, "Your faith has healed you." So we're left with no doubt that this woman had real faith in the real Jesus Christ. But secondly, also, we see that it's a slightly superstitious faith in Jesus. Why didn't she approach Jesus directly, like the synagogue leader did? Why this touch the cloak and run option? Why was she fixated on an item of clothing rather than engaging with him as a person? It was a strange approach. It wasn't the strong, clearer faith of the synagogue leader or the blind man whom we meet shortly. So in a sense, it was a weak faith, yet it was a real faith in Jesus. And I'm going to speak a word of encouragement to you this morning if you feel that your faith in Jesus is weak. And I think that's all of us to some degree. Not in the sense that you don't expect Jesus to heal you from a particular illness you have. That's not what we're talking about today. But you sense that your faith is weak because you find it difficult to access and to experience God's comfort in the midst of all of life's challenges. Maybe that's you this morning. If that's you, and I said it's all of us to some degree, remember that a weak faith in Jesus Christ A Christian with a weak faith is no less eternally secure, no less eternally saved, and no less a child of God in the family of God than a strong Christian with a strong faith which can move mountains. Because it's the object of the faith that matters. Are your eyes on Jesus? He can save you. Your faith in Jesus has saved you. If you're trusting in Christ, your faith might be weak, but you are a child of God. And can I urge you to pray the prayer which the disciples asked of Jesus elsewhere? Lord, increase our faith. And pray also that you would experience more of God's comfort to be a reality in your heart, more of God's peace, more of God's joy in your suffering. Because ultimately this woman, however misguided her faith was in some aspects, she really wasn't messing around. She was in desperate need. She came to Jesus for help. She directed her eyes on Jesus, where so many others had failed. She trusted him. It was real. Brothers and sisters, keep your eyes on Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. That's the second encounter Jesus has here, the desperate faith of a despairing woman. Thirdly, the insightful faith of two blind men. The insightful faith of two blind men. So we're sort of asking the question, isn't it? We're reading a lot of healings of disabled people here. What do the gospel accounts of healings of disabled people mean today, with all the disabled people we know in society? One writer for the BBC, Damon Rose, wrote this. Like many disabled people, I'm often approached by Christians who want to pray for me to be healed. While they may be well-intentioned, these encounters often leave me feeling judged as faulty and in need of repair. So I set out to discover what Christianity has to offer disabled people beyond promises and miracle cures. You can read the rest of the article online. It's very interesting. But that's a good question, isn't it? What does Christianity offer disabled people? We know people at world's end with disabilities beyond promises of miracle cures. We'll look at Matthew 9:27. There's also an account of the healing of two blind men later in Matthew's Gospel, in Matthew 20. But I'll read this one. As Jesus went on from there, two blind men followed him, calling out, "Have mercy on us, son of David." When he had gone indoors, the blind men came to him, and he asked them, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" "Yes, Lord," they replied. Then he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." And their sight was restored. Jesus warned them sternly, "See that no one knows about this." But they went out and spread the news about him all over that region. Two blind men. These men had less evidence about Jesus to go on than other people. Others could see the miracles that Jesus had done with their own eyes. The blind men couldn't. They had to rely on what others would tell them, things that they heard about Jesus. And yet they trusted in Jesus. Their faith was real. They called out to Jesus as the son of David, the promised one from the royal line of David, the promised king, the Messiah. They followed him. And Jesus healed them on the basis of that faith. It was just what the prophet Isaiah prophesied many years before. We read, "Be strong and do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout joy." What does Jesus offer disabled people? What do we at Hope Church want to offer disabled people? Well, not dramatic healings in answer to unwanted prayers. We offer certain hope, a restored relationship with God through the Lord Jesus Christ, God's promised King, who came to reconcile sinners like us with God. Because the point is, we've all turned our backs on God, whether we're disabled or not. And Jesus can take away the judgment we deserve. He can restore harmony between us and God and give us his Holy Spirit to live in us. And we all have minds and bodies that are not what they should be, or we certainly will in a few years' time, whether we're disabled or not. But Jesus offers us a new world, through faith in him with no more tears, no more pain, no more suffering to all who trust in him, whether disabled or not. And that's good news for everyone, regardless of how able-bodied we are. The insight of faith for two blind men. And finally, very briefly, and this comes as a bit of a negative, nasty twist at the end of positive responses to Jesus, the defiant unbelief of the jealous Pharisees, verse 32 to 34. So far we've seen positive responses, but this one group are jealous, and it takes one more miracle, just one more, to tip them over the edge. While they were going out, verse 32, a man who was demon-possessed and could not talk was brought to Jesus. And when the demon was driven out, the man who had been mute spoke. The crowd was amazed and said, "Nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "It is by the prince of demons that he drives out demons." Oh, how sour the Pharisees are. No concern for the people who needed healing. They couldn't care less whether they were healed or not. No rejoicing, unlike the crowds, when these people were healed. Rather, all that came out of their mouths was what was in their hearts, which was cruel, irrational hatred for Jesus and all that he stood for. And that spewed out of their mouths. What is the main response that Jesus is calling us to in this section of Matthew? Well, faith, trust in him. And on the flip side, what is the biggest sin? It's the Pharisees, it's that unbelief, refusal to trust, lack of, complete absence of faith. The Pharisees know so much of the Bible, they discuss it, they teach it, but they don't accept Jesus as the Messiah, the one promised in the line of David, like the two blind men. The two blind men put them to shame. They missed the whole point why God gave us the Bible. The defiant unbelief of the Pharisees. Where is God in the pain and mess of our lives? The Jesus who we meet in the pages of Matthew's Gospel, this same Jesus lives today. He rose from the dead. He's ascended to the Father. He lives. He's at the right hand of God. He's our great high priest. And he lives to help you, to help me, as well as reigning over the entire universe. He's strong and he's kind. He's able to help you, and he's willing to help you. The question is, will you trust him to look after you? Will you trust him? Jesus wants you to trust him, trust him, trust him. Trust him the first time. If you've not yet trusted in Jesus, trust him that first time. Trust him the next time. Trust him through the next trial, and the next, and the next. Trust him all the way through the pain and mess of this life, until he shepherds us safely home, where there will be no more pain, no more mess, and no more need for faith either, because the God we now worship on the basis of what he's revealed about himself in his word by his Spirit, we will see face to face. If we have trusted, we will now live by faith, we will see by sight, we will know him fully on that day, even as we are fully known. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we do pray that you would come soon. We long to be with you. We confess that we find it hard to trust you with all the trials, all the distractions of this life. But would you give us a faith that lasts, a faith which results in praise to you because it is genuine. Lord, where our faith is weak and insufficient in some ways, like that wonderful woman who was so committed and yet got something wrong, Lord, correct and strengthen our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Grow our comfort and our joy as we fix our eyes on him. And comfort us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, in our final song, we're going to encourage each other to keep living by faith in Jesus and his promises. Do stand up. More of God's joy and comfort as we trust in him. So let's pray this prayer together as we finish.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace as we trust in him, so that we may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Do have a seat.
Thank you.